So today we'll be discussing about the contents in Unit 6, and Unit 6 is basically on oscillator circuits. Now in last unit, we have discussed about the feedback circuits in much more detail. And while discussing the feedback circuits, we have also considered the different topologies of feedback network, like current series network, voltage shunt, current shunt, and voltage series. Now to discuss about the oscillator circuit, let us first begin with the fundamental block diagram of any feedback network. So as you know, for any feedback network, we essentially have two different units. One is the feed network, having a gain of say A. And the second one is the back network, having a corresponding feedback factor of B. Now, there are two different processes involved. At the output end, we have the sampling process. The output of the feed network is connected over here at the input of the back network, which is known as the sampling process. And at the input side, we have the mixing operation between the externally applied input and the output of the back network. So this has been discussed already in the last unit while we have taken up the feedback networks. So we have also seen that the gain corresponding to the feedback network is given by A upon 1 plus AB, where A is the open loop gain of the feedback network or feed network. And while connecting this back network with this feed network, the corresponding gain has been reduced by a factor 1 plus AB, which is known as the desensitivity factor. Now let us consider the input over here. Suppose the input over here, if I consider this input suppose given by S epsilon, for example. This is Si, this one is say Sf, and this one is Sp. So right now I'm considering S as signal, so it could have been either voltage or current. So you know, for a negative feedback, this S epsilon is given by Si minus Sf, and for positive feedback, S epsilon is given by Si plus Sf. Now for the time being, if I just consider this S epsilon, this particular input, which is being fed to the feed network, the corresponding loop gain as perceived by this particular signal is given by A times B. If S epsilon is applied over here, then this is multiplied by a factor A. Then the same signal is once again multiplied by the feedback network, and the signal which you obtained over here is experiencing a loop gain given by A into B. Now, so far in our discussion in the last unit, we have considered that this feedback network is essentially consisting of the resistive elements. For example, we have seen that either we have this feedback factor in unit of resistance or conductance, or in some cases, this feedback factor is nothing but a ratio of two resistances. So in a nutshell, we can say that the feedback network, within this back network, we only have resistance. And as you know, resistance is not at all frequency selective. For any resistance, V is equal to R into I, that particular relationship, this Ohm's law, is applicable irrespective of the frequency of operation. Whether we apply 1 kilohertz signal, or we apply 100 kilohertz signal, or we apply 1 megahertz signal, V is equal to R into I, that particular relationship is always maintained. And the voltage and the current relationship will be given by the Ohm's law. That means if the voltage signal is having a frequency of say 100 kilohertz, then the current signal will also be having a frequency of 100 kilohertz. But while considering the oscillator circuit in our discussion, the fundamental change that we are making in the overall block of this feedback network is that the back network, this B, will consist of frequency selective elements. So apart from resistance, sometimes we need to connect some capacitance in this feedback network or in this back network, And in some other case, we have to connect both L and C, both inductor and capacitor in this particular back network. So accordingly, we could have two different types of oscillator. So in case this B or back network consists of R and C, resistance and capacitance, in that case, we will be having what is known as RC oscillator. And if this back network consists of L and C, inductor and capacitor, then we have what is known as LC oscillator. So unlike a simple feedback amplifiers, what we have discussed in the last unit, or last module, here we can find the presence of frequency selective elements. As you know, both capacitor and inductor, they are frequency selective elements. So the corresponding reactance as provided by this capacitor and inductor, they depends heavily upon the frequency of operation. So this is the one change, the first change, which we must introduce while discussing the oscillator circuit. Then comes the corresponding loop gain. Now, before considering the loop gain, let me tell you, since this back network, since this feedback factor is essentially a function of frequency, so instead of writing only B, it will be customary to represent B as a function of S. So I can write this feedback network or back network is having a feedback factor given by B as a function of S. So as a matter of fact, the overall gain with feedback, that could have also been written like this. If I consider that we are considering in the midband region of operation where the gain is constant for the amplifier itself. So I can write this like 1 plus A into BS. And the loop gain, as I've already mentioned, the loop gain, if I represent by means of TS, this loop gain is given by A into BS. So here we are intentionally assuming that a negative feedback is applying. So that's why over here we find that the feedback, I mean the gain with feedback is given by A upon 1 plus AB. Now this derivation has already been done in the last unit. So I'm not going into the derivation yet. Now, if this feedback, I mean, if this TS, what is known as the loop gain, if this loop gain approaches minus 1, then what happens? If this A into BS, if this particular factor, this loop gain, if it approaches towards minus 1, so you find that the gain with feedback becomes infinite, because in the denominator side, we have 1 plus A into BS. Now, in case A into BS equal to minus 1, then the AFS value will become infinite. So what is the implication of having an infinite gain with feedback? It means that gain equal to infinite means that even for no input, even for zero input, you will find that there is a finite output. So as you know, the overall gain with feedback is given by the ratio of two different variables, two different signal, what is known as this S0 upon SI. Because for the entire feedback network, SI is the input and SO being the output. So the gain with feedback, AFS, is nothing but the ratio between S0 by SI. Now, under the condition when the loop gain TS approaching towards minus 1, then you find that AFS becoming infinite, which means that you'll be having some finite output even for a zero input. So even the input is zero, even if we don't apply any external input at this particular point, then also you will find that there is a finite output. Now, this particular thing is happening for a particular value of frequency or for a range of frequency. Now, if I get this condition that TS equal to minus 1, if this condition is satisfied, if the condition of having TS equal to minus 1, that means the loop gain equal to minus 1, in which case the circuit becomes nonlinear, if this condition TS equal to minus 1 is achieved for a particular value of frequency, then at the output side, we will be having a signal consisting of a single frequency. And as you know, a signal consisting of a single frequency is nothing but a sinusoidal signal, because sinusoidal signal is the only signal present in the earth which is having a single frequency, a monotone signal. as we normally refer to. On the other hand, if TS equal to minus 1, if this condition is satisfied for a wider range of frequency, then you have a different types of oscillator, unlike a sinusoidal oscillator. So we'll be discussing this one in a later time. Now to start with, this TS equal to minus 1, this particular condition is known as the Barkhausen condition for oscillation. This condition is known as Barkhausen condition of oscillation. So what is the significance of this Barkhausen condition? The significance is that the loop gain of the signal over here equal to minus 1. That means if I consider the magnitude S epsilon at this particular point, then after this S epsilon is propagated through this feed network and once again through this frequency selective back network, we will be getting the same signal but with a different phase. Now remember, already here we have inserted one negative sign because we are considering here the negative feedback. So SI and SF, so they are in the opposite phase. So even if SI was zero over here, so instead of adding, we will be having a negative sign over here. So minus. So this one is plus, this one is minus. So even if SI is equal to zero, so you must appreciate that the SF, the signal which will be obtained at the output of this back network, is added in opposite phase. Now, so far, we have seen that if A into B is equal to minus 1, that means already 180 degree phase difference has been established. Then, when it is being provided at the input of a summer with a negative value, that means at the input of a subtractor, then the total phase difference from this point to once again at this point is equal to 180 degree plus 180 degree, that is total phase shift becoming 360 degree. That means there is no phase shift at all, because as you know, 0 degree phase difference and 360 degree phase difference being the same. Now let me summarize. You have one signal over here. Suppose SI is absent. SI is absent, there is no externally connected input signal over here. By some means, you have generated some signal S epsilon over here that is becoming present because of some noise signal. Now, this signal will be propagated through this feed network having a gain of A, and the output of the feed network is being provided at the input of the back network having a feedback factor of BS, since B is a function of frequency over here. So the total loop gain as perceived by this particular input signal is given by A times BS. Now, if this A times BS is equal to minus 1, so at this particular point, you will be having minus S epsilon because you have provided S epsilon over here, A times S epsilon at this particular point, and A times BS times S epsilon at this particular point at the output of the back network. Now, if this condition is true that A into BS equal to minus 1, that TS equal to minus 1, that means at this particular point, you will be having minus of S epsilon. Then another negative sign over here. So minus of minus S epsilon will become plus S epsilon. So once again, at the output, you will be having A times S epsilon, even if SI equal to 0. Now, if this condition is satisfied only for a single frequency, then we'll be having a sinusoidal oscillator. But if this condition is satisfied over a wide range of frequency, then we will be having non-sinusoidal oscillator. That means at the output SO, we will be having some signal which consists more than one frequency. Moreover, TS equal to minus 1, this particular condition is also needed for sustained oscillation. So what do you mean by sustained oscillation? So the first and foremost question which must come into your mind is that how to initiate the operation of oscillation. As we have already mentioned, that there is no externally connected input signal. So initially, there could have been some noise from which the initial signal could have been generated. Now, as you know, the noise signal is generally wide band. That means the noise signal consists of a large range of frequency. If I consider a kind of white noise for which the presence of all the frequency component being the same, so for this type of noise, there could have been a number of frequency components present. Now, This condition is not satisfied for all frequency, as I've already mentioned. This condition TS equal to minus 1 is satisfied only for a single frequency for the design of sinusoidal oscillator. Now, there could have been some other frequency present within the noise. For example, if the noise ranges from, say, few tens of hertz to few hundreds of kilohertz. For example, the noise is existing for a few, say, 20 of hertz to, say hundreds of kilohertz. That is the range of noise signal, just like this. So if I just want to represent the noise by means of some, I mean, if I just draw the PSD of the noise, power spectral density of the noise, power versus frequency. So it might look something like that. So noise component is having very small, insignificantly small. So it will be something like that, on wide band noise. So say 0 to F1, say 0 to F1, so the frequency component is being present. So suppose F1 equal to, say, a few hundreds of, let it be, say, 100 kilohertz. So initially, this noise is present. Now, this condition TS equal to minus 1 is satisfied only for a particular frequency, and that frequency suppose belongs to 0 to F1. If I consider that frequency to be F star, so F star is within the range 0 to F1. So that means we could have some frequency F star over here that belongs within that particular range. So for the other value of frequency, this particular condition is not satisfied. It is satisfied only for a single frequency. So TS equal to minus 1, this is satisfied only for F is equal to F star, where F star belonging to 0 to F1. So at the output, we will be having a sinusoidal signal over here only for a single frequency, only for a frequency equal to F star. So that frequency is given by F star. It is generated from a noise signal, a wideband noise signal, for which the frequency is ranging from 0 to F1. But for the other values of frequency, apart from F star, since this condition is not satisfied, so the oscillation is not at all sustained. Right? So oscillation is not at all sustained. The oscillation is sustained only for a single frequency, and that frequency is given by F star, any frequency within that particular range. And if this is a single frequency, then we can have a sinusoidal oscillator like this. Now, once again, looking back at the fundamental circuit of an oscillator, we'll find that the total phase difference from this point, while the signal travels through this, and once again, when it comes over here, the total phase difference must be equal to n into 360 degree. N times 360 degree. That means there is total phase difference of 0 degree in practical. There is 180 degree phase difference as imposed by this feedback network, this loop gain, A beta S or A BS. Since it is minus 1, so it involves 180 degree phase difference, and another additional 180 degree phase difference is incorporated by providing this input, this output of the back network to a subtractor. Since there is a negative sign over here, so another 180 degree phase difference will be imposed over here. So altogether, the signal will experience a phase difference of 180 degree plus 180 degree. So total phase difference will become 360 degree, or in other words, there is no phase difference. For example, if I assume this signal equal to 1 volt, for example, if this signal is equal to 1 volt and A is equal to, say, 10 and B is equal to, say, 0.1. So 1 into 10, so it will become 10 at this particular point. Then 10, it is once again multiplied with 0.1, that is 0.1. 10 into 0.1, it will become 1. So 1 at this particular point with a negative sign. And then there is another negative sign over here. So once again, you'll be having 1 over here. So you'll be having at the output of the oscillator a 10 volt signal like this, if this input is equal to 1 only. But for the other frequency of operation, since this condition is not at all satisfied, so the oscillation will not be sustained. So this is the fundamental idea behind the design of an oscillator circuit. And depending upon the design of this back network, so we could have two different types of oscillators, as I have already mentioned. One is known as RC oscillator, and the second one is known as LC oscillator. Now, in the syllabus, we have two different RC oscillators to discuss with, and we have two other LC oscillators as well. Now, to start with, let us take the very popular and famous RC oscillator, which is known as the phase shift RC oscillator. Now, in case of phase shift RC oscillator, we will be designing one common emitter amplifier, single stage common emitter amplifier, which itself provides a 180 degree phase difference. This common emitter, as you know, for a common emitter amplifier, single stage amplifier, it provides 180 degree phase difference between its input and output. Input is obtained or input is applied at the base side, and the output is obtained at the collector side. So base to collector, there is 180 degree phase difference. And once again, from collector to the base, there is another back network connected, and which back network provides additional 180 degree phase difference. So total phase difference will become 360 degree only. In other words, there is a 0 degree phase difference. Now, how to generate that particular network, this BS network, this back network? So we could realize this by means of connecting three RC high pass filters, so that each of these networks will provide 60 degree phase difference. And if they are identical in nature, then three such RC block will provide total 180 degree phase difference. Now let us try to understand how does the circuit look like and what is the frequency of operation for this particular RC oscillator. Now this is known as RC phase shift oscillator. So RC phase shift oscillator. Now, first of all, let me draw the common emitter model, common emitter amplifier involving very simple biasing arrangement, single stage common emitter. So just like this. So this is the supply line. This is the supply line VCC. Suppose this is RB, this one is RC, this is RE. Now this is the output. This is the output. Now from output to input, there will be a back network connected. So the back network looks something like that. Now let us try to represent using a different color. So this is the back network. Now let me design the back network first. So from output to input, there is a back network. So there is a capacitor over here, then resistance. So there will be three RC network. Identical one. Identical one, three RC networks. Now the circuit which I draw using this green. So this basically identifies the back network, and the circuit which I have drawn using this blue, this is nothing but the amplifier circuit. So eventually we have like three capacitors over here and three identical networks like R over here. But remember, for the last stage, I'm just intentionally representing it by means of some R dashed, because I know that ultimately the equivalent capacitance, I mean equivalent resistance over here must be R. Now what happens here between base to emitter? So once again, another thing what I can do over here is, I can make, I mean, this one grounded by means of this bypass capacitor, so that emitter terminal is essentially at ground, AC ground. Now, if I draw the small signal equivalent circuit over here, between base to emitter, what we find is between base to emitter, as you know, between base emitter, there will be three different resistance. One resistance is in the form of RB, because the other end of RB is at VCC, which is at AC ground. So this is, we have RB over here, base emitter. Then another resistance coming from the property of the transistor, which is nothing but R pi. As you know, between base emitter, there will be R pi. And the third resistance, which is there, is R dash, which we have connected externally. So accordingly, there will be three different resistance connected. So all of them are connected together between base to emitter or base to ground. So this is grounded eventually. So this is R dash. So that's why, in order to make sense that the overall resistance over here is nothing but R. So I have selected R dash over here with a condition that RB parallel R pi parallel R dash is equal to the R. So ultimately, if I just look at the small signal equivalent circuit, we will be seeing that the corresponding values are like C, R, C, R, and C, R in the small signal equivalent circuit. So three identical RC stages, RC high pass network, we have designed in the form of back network. Moreover, let me try to mention the corresponding voltage point. Suppose this one is V naught. Suppose this one is, for example, this is say, let it be VA. At this point, suppose this is VB, and this point suppose VO dashed. So we have VO as the output over here, which is connected to the input of the back network. So output of the amplifier circuit, this is the amplifier involving this resistance RB, RC, RE, CE, and the transistor itself. So this one involves the amplifier circuit having a gain of A, and the output of the amplifier is connected to the input of the back network. Now back network involves RC networks over here, three identical RC stages, C, R, C, R, and C, R dashed. Why R dashed? I have already explained. And the output of the back network is connected to the input of the amplifier circuit itself. So there is no externally connected input signal. As you observe over here, there is no externally connected input signal. The output of the back network from this particular point, we are feeding the amplifier itself. Now we have to calculate the frequency of oscillation for this particular circuit. Now before that, you have to identify what should be the relationship that must be maintained over here. As you know, from this point to this point, V naught dash to V naught, as you know, there will be a 180 degree phase difference from V naught dash to V naught, because we have a common emitter amplifier, single stage common emitter amplifier. So as a matter of fact, the corresponding phase difference will be 180 degree. So we have to ensure that this RC network, it must provide additional 180 degree phase difference. That means VO to VA, VA to VB, and VB to VO dashed, they must provide the additional 180 degree phase difference. Now, before discussing further how to solve this circuit, let me give you a very, simplest way to calculate this one. The circuit is a little bit complicated. Now to identify this one, let me give you a very fundamental knowledge about circuit theory. Suppose there are two impedances just like this. I have two impedances connected in this fashion. I don't know what is there inside. So that's why I'm representing by some impedance Z2, and this one is Z1. And suppose the voltage that I'm getting at this particular point, suppose this voltage is V1, and this voltage at this particular point, let it be V2. So as you know how to calculate this one, V2 is given by V1 upon Z1 plus Z2 into Z1 into Z2. Into Z2. So from the voltage divided law. So V2 by V1, that ratio can be represented by z2 upon z1 plus z2. Now, instead of representing in terms of z, if I want to represent in terms of admittance, so it will be like 1 upon y2 divided by 1 upon y1 plus 1 upon y2. So if you substitute the value, if you simplify, you will find that it is nothing but y1 upon y1 plus y2. So if you have two voltages like this, suppose in my circuit, I can have a voltage over here V1 and voltage over here V2, and the corresponding loads are given by Z1 and Z2, the corresponding impedances. So what is Z2? Z2 is nothing but the load across V2. So then I can represent the ratio between two voltages V2 upon V1 in this fashion, Y1 upon Y1 plus Y2, where Y1 is the corresponding admittance of this particular load and Y2 is the admittance corresponding to this particular load. So I have to apply this fundamental thing during the calculation. Let me go to the next slide and let me draw it very quickly. The circuit itself, the back network itself, I need to draw first of all. So I need to draw the back network because the feed network is simply a single stage common emitter amplifier. So let me draw the back network. So how does it look like, the back network? So if this one is V naught, so these are grounded. So this one is C, this is also C, identical networks, R, R. And in the small signal equivalent circuit, we'll be having R over here because R dashed, RB, R pi, when they are connected in shunt, I have to assume that this condition is maintained. So C. So this voltage I have referred like VA, voltage at this particular point VA, voltage at this particular point VB, and voltage at this particular point VO dashed. Now I have to find out the ratio between V naught and VA, then VA and VB, then VB by V naught dashed. Now to start with, let me start with from the extreme right. Suppose I would like to find out the ratio between V naught dashed and VB. So between these two points, what is the voltage? Between these two points, the voltage is nothing but VB. And between these two points, what is the voltage? Is nothing but V naught dashed. Now, considering that particular formula, which you have just now established, I can write V naught dashed upon VB is given by the admittance of this one divided by the admittance of this one plus admittance of this one. So what is the admittance of this one? As you know, for a capacitor, the impedance is given by 1 upon SC. So the admittance is given by SC only. So the admittance is SC only divided by over here. What is the admittance? SC plus 1 by R. So I followed that particular formula. So this is given by SRC upon 1 plus SRC. This is V0 dashed upon VB. Now that is very easy to find out. Next comes the ratio between VB and VA. The ratio between VB and VA. Now over here, the voltage is VA. Between these two points, the voltage is VA. And at this particular point, VB is there, the voltage across this. But what about the load? If I want to find out the load, so VB is the potential at this particular point. This is the potential, VB. At point B, the potential is VB. Then what about the total load? We have this R and this C, they are connected in series for this particular position. We have R and C, they are connected in series, and the whole thing is connected in shunt with R. So that is the total load appearing across this particular point at the point B. So we need to calculate accordingly. So what is the admittance over here? R and C. So for this one, R plus 1 plus SC. And then we have another R there in shunt. So what about the total admittance? So let me write down in terms of VB upon VA. So this impedance, I mean this admittance, I can write in terms of SC only. Then this Y1 I can write in terms of SC. Then what about Y2? So Y2, let me calculate outside. So we have R and 1 by SC, they are in series. This R and this SC, 1 by SC, they are in series. And the whole thing is in parallel with this R. So what about the total admittance? 1 upon this plus 1 upon R. This is the total admittance over here. So plus 1 upon R plus 1 upon R plus 1 by SC. So let me just simplify this one. We have SC over here, then SC plus 1 by R plus, if I multiply both the numerator and denominator by SC, it will become SC by 1 plus SRC. So then, if I multiply both the numerator and denominator by R into 1 plus SRC, then it becomes SRC into 1 plus SRC in the numerator divided by SRC into 1 plus SRC. Plus, so we need to multiply this with R into 1 plus SRC. So that is SRC into 1 plus SRC. Then over here, I need to multiply it with 1 plus SRC only. So 1 plus SRC plus SRC. So if I simplify this one, it becomes SRC into 1 plus SRC divided by, we have 1 plus SRC, so 3 SRC plus SRC whole square. So this is the ratio between VB and VA. And to get the last one, what we do is we just copy this one. Yeah, I think I missed some part. Anyway, let me draw fresh. The last one, it will be even more complicated. One second, let me draw. This is the second stage, the third stage. So this one is VA, this one VB, this is VO dashed, R, this is C. This one is VO. So now we are interested in calculating the ratio between VA and VO. So far we have calculated V0 dashed upon VB and VB upon VA. Now we need to calculate VA upon VO. So over here, first of all, there are two stages of RC. this RC is in series, the whole thing is in shunt with R, and then this is in series with C. So it will be a little bit difficult. So let me start with this point, or it will be better if I name it differently, like C1, C2, C3, R3, R2, R1. Obviously, C1 equal to C2 equal to C3 equal to C, and R1 equal to R2 equal to R3 equal to R. Now I have named for the ease of calculation only. So we have R3 and C3 in series. So it will be like R3 plus 1 by SC3. The entire thing is in shunt with R2. So I have to find out the admittance and add them together, 1 upon R2. So this is the total admittance. Then this whole thing is in series with C2. So if it is in series, so I have to add the impedance. So 1 upon this plus 1 upon SC2. This is the total impedance at this particular point. Now the entire thing must be in shunt with R1. So since it is shunt with R1, so I have to find out the admittance once again. So 1 by this plus 1 by R1. So this is the total admittance at point A. So at point A, this is the total admittance. And over here, the admittance is only SC1. So now we are in a position to simplify the whole thing. VA upon VO. Y1 upon Y1 plus Y2. So this is basically our Y2 as you have called so far. And Y1 is the same SC1. So I can write like only SC. And over here I should write Y1 plus Y2. So what is Y2? SC plus 1 by R. So now I am making this change that R1 equal to R2 is equal to R3 is equal to R plus 1 upon 1 by SC plus 1 by R plus 1 by R plus 1 by SC. So this is the entire thing what we have arrived right now. So I need to simplify this one. So this is like the numerator, we have SC only. Numerator we have SC only. The denominator we have, let me calculate 1 by 1, then 1 upon 1 by SC plus 1 by 1 by R plus, now this one. So if I multiply both the numerator and denominator by SC, so it becomes SC by 1 plus SRC. 1 plus SRC. That is equal to SC over here, SC plus 1 by R plus 1 by SC. Now if I multiply the entire thing with R into 1 plus SRC, both the numerator and denominator, then you have R into 1 plus SRC divided by one plus SRC plus SRC. Let me check once again. We have SC over here, SC plus 1 by R plus 1 upon 1 by SC. If I just once again take a look at this particular form, we have R3 and C3, so they are in a series. So R3 plus 1 by SC3. Then the entire thing is in shunt with R2. So 1 upon this plus 1 upon R2. Then we have plus 1 upon SC2, the corresponding impedance. And the whole thing is in shunt with R1. So 1 upon this plus 1 upon R1. So that is equal to your Y2. So let me go to the next slide. This is a little bit complicated one, that ratio. So we have SC over here. Then we have SC plus 1 upon R plus 1 upon plus 1 upon, we have 1 by SC plus 1 by SC plus, I think, R into 1 plus SRC divided by 1 plus 2 SRC. So R into 1 plus SRC divided by 1 plus 2 SRC. So this is the formula. So SC divided by SC plus 1 by R plus 1 by if I multiply it, if I just substitute this one. So you have 1 plus 2 SRC over here plus SRC into 1 plus SRC. So then you have SC plus 1 by R plus 1 plus 2 SRC divided by 1 plus 3 SRC plus, I'm just calculating this part, 1 plus 3 SRC plus SRC whole square. So which gives rise to numerator, we have SC. Now denominator, I can now simplify this one together. R into 1 plus 3 SRC plus S square, R square, C square. Then it is nothing but SRC into the entire thing, 1 plus 3 SRC plus SRC whole square plus one plus three SRC plus SRC whole square plus SRC into 1 plus 2 SRC. Then ultimately, if it is multiplied, so it is SRC into 1 plus 3 SRC plus a square r square c square in the numerator, and in the denominator we have 1 over here then we have 1 src 3 src 4 src and 5 src so 5 src now as far as the src whole square is concerned we have over here 3 src whole square 1 4 src whole square plus 2 6 src whole square I mean 6 a square r square c square and we have src whole cube only so this is the complicated expression for v a upon vo so now in the next slide let me summarize what we have got so far we have got like the first one let me summarize with the diagram itself we have three rc networks so this one is all of them r this is c this is vo va over here vb over here and vo dashed so for the back network if I just want to represent in this format for the back network the input was vo and the output was vo dashed then you need to find out any of the ratio either vo by vo dashed or vo dashed by vo then what is the feedback factor the feedback factor is given by vo dashed upon vo so that could have been represented by vo dashed upon vb into vb by va into va by vo now we have already got v not dashed by vb that is given by in this slide we have got like src by 1 plus src so this is given by src by 1 plus src then comes vb by va so vb by va we have also derived this is given by SRC into 1 plus SRC by this one. So this is nothing but SRC by SRC into 1 plus SRC. SRC into 1 plus SRC by 1 plus 3 SRC plus SRC whole square. Let me check once again. SRC into 1 plus SRC into 1 plus 3 SRC plus SRC whole square. And the last one, which we have derived right now, this is nothing but the ratio between VA and VO. So this VA by VO, this ratio is like SRC into 1 plus 3 SRC plus SRC whole square. Divided by 1 plus 3 SRC plus 1 plus 5 SRC plus 6 SRC whole square 1 plus 5 SRC so 1 plus 5 SRC plus 6 SRC whole square plus src whole cube so now if I just calculate v not dashed upon vo va sorry v not dashed by vo this is nothing but so I am not once again writing out the same thing rather let us try to multiply So let me represent them by means of some marked box. So I need to multiply these three different factors. And this one, and this third one, this one. If I multiply, I'll find that this denominator and this numerator, so they are getting cancelled. This 1 plus SRC is also getting cancelled. So ultimately, in the numerator, we have SRC whole cube. The numerator, we have SRC whole cube. And in the denominator, we have 1 plus 5 SRC plus 6 SRC whole square plus SRC whole cube. Now, if I want to represent S by means of J into omega, this is nothing but, if I represent J S as J omega, you know, to find out the corresponding frequency of oscillation. So it will become like J Q means minus J. So minus J times omega cube R cube C cube divided by 1 minus 1 plus 5 J omega RC minus 6 omega RC whole square, because J square is minus 1, and plus then minus J omega cube R cube C cube. Now, this is the expression for the back network. We know that the feed network, this single stage common unit amplifier, it will provide a corresponding phase difference of 180 degree. So this particular back network must also provide additional phase difference of 180 degree, so that the total phase difference becomes only 360 degree or 0 degree. Now, over here, in the numerator side, what you can find is, we have minus J times omega cube R cube into C cube. And the denominator side, we have 1 plus 5 J omega RC minus 6 omega RC whole square minus J omega cube R cube C cube. So in order to make that this particular thing will provide 180 degree phase difference, the condition that is obtained over here is that, so let me once again write down the expression for the feedback factor. This feedback factor is given by minus J omega cube R cube C cube divided by 1 minus 6 omega square R square C square. So this is the real part. And then we have plus 5 J omega R C minus J omega cube R cube C cube. Now, to ensure that this back network provides 180 degree phase difference, as we have started with, because each of these networks, each of these RC networks will provide 60 degree phase difference each. So there are three different RC networks, so all of them will provide 180 degree phase difference. So now, to ensure that, the condition which must be satisfied is 1 minus 6 omega square R square C square must be 0. Now, if this condition is satisfied, then from that we can easily find out this omega RC to be 1 by 6, 1 by root 6 rather, or omega is equal to 1 by RC into root 6. Or the frequency of oscillation F is given by 1 by 2 pi root 6 RC. Now, under this condition, if this 1 minus 6 omega square R square C square is equal to 0, then what is the value of B? Then B becomes minus J omega cube R cube C cube upon 5 j omega r c minus j omega cube r cube c cube. So if I get rid of j omega r c both from the numerator as well as from the denominator, so then we have g omega rc, if it is removed from both the from the numerator as well as from the denominator, then we have omega square r square c square with a negative sign outside, and over here we have 5 minus omega square r square c square. So then the value of B at this particular frequency is given by, let me check once again whether, yeah, then the value of B is given by, if I just put the value, omega RC is equal to 1 by root 6. If I put the value omega RC is equal to 1 by root 6, under this condition, omega r square c square is given by 1 upon 6. So I can take minus n outside. So you have 1 by 6 over here and 5 minus 1 by 6 over here. So ultimately, the value is nothing but 1 upon 29. At the singular frequency, f is equal to 1 by 2 pi root 6 rc. The feedback network or back network will provide 180 degree phase difference, which is represented by this minus sign outside, and the corresponding feedback factor is given by 1 by 29. Now, as far as our understanding goes in oscillator circuit, the total phase difference must be equal to 360 degree, and the loop gain, if I just consider the magnitude of the loop gain, this magnitude must be equal to 1. So for the feedback network, if I just once again go back to the original circuit, so this particular network provides 180 degree phase difference, and the corresponding attenuation provided by this circuit is nothing but 1 by 29. So to compensate that particular attenuation, this amplifier circuit, this single stage amplifier circuit, must provide a gain of 29. And 180 degree phase difference over here is already compensated by another 180 degree phase difference by the single stage amplifier. So we can write down the expression for gain for the amplifier itself. The amplifier must provide a gain of 29 so that sustained oscillation is possible, and it will generate a sinusoidal signal like this at the output of this particular circuit, and the frequency of oscillation for this particular sinusoidal signal is given by 1 by 2 pi root 6 into RC. So just by tuning the value of R and C, which you have connected over here, you can basically change the oscillation frequency over here. For this phase shift oscillator circuit, it is also known as three-phase oscillator. This phase shift oscillator circuit consisting of three RC network, phase shift oscillator, RC oscillator. The corresponding frequency of operation is normally, or if I just consider the oscillation frequency, this oscillation frequency is normally given by this particular value, and this is normally in the range of few hundreds of kilohertz. You can tune the value from few tens of hertz to few hundreds of kilohertz. But for very high frequency, if you'd like to obtain from this particular network, this is not at all possible. There is some limitation of this circuit. So you can have around, say, few tens of kilohertz or even max to max 100 kilohertz frequency oscillation. Otherwise, this particular amplifier will not be having a constant gain, because as you know, this A into BS must be equal to minus 1. A into BS must be equal to minus 1. The total loop gain must be equal to minus 1. So as to ensure the Barkhausen condition. But if you go for very high frequency, then you cannot ensure that this gain is becoming constant at 29. So as long as you have calculated this one, this expression that F is equal to 1 by 2 pi root 6 RC. So we have assumed that the corresponding back network provides an attenuation of 1 by 29. So to compensate that one, this amplifier circuit must be having a gain equal to 29. But to ensure that, we must be in the mid-band region of our operation. For example, once again, if I just draw the circuit, I mean, this frequency response of the amplifier, as you know, it looks something like that. So far, we have constricted ourselves within that particular region, where gain is fairly constant. Now, if you make any attempt to increase this frequency, this F, to few hundreds of megahertz or tens of megahertz beyond some hundreds of kilohertz, then what happens? The gain will no longer be constant, because to ensure this Huston oscillation, gain must be constant and the constant value must be equal to 29. So this is one of the limitation of this phase shift oscillator circuit, that you cannot go beyond a certain range, certain frequency. But in most of the cases, this circuit is much more popular. And in this particular unit, in this particular subject, since we have dealt with only BJT, so that's why we have drawn the circuit for using the bipolar junction transistor. But in many of the books, you can also find that this same RC oscillator circuit, this phase shift oscillator circuit, is also implemented by using op amps, operational amplifiers. But since this one has not been yet introduced to you, so intentionally I have just avoided that part. I have not introduced op amp in this course, and I have designed the circuit using only bipolar junction transistor. So using op amp, you can have another circuit for phase shift oscillator. There also you can see that there could have been two different frequency operation depending upon the connection, depending upon the circuit configuration. So anyway, so I think our discussion on phase shift oscillator circuit is over for this one. And it is another important circuit which we must not forget to mention, and that is about the Weinbridge oscillator circuit. So with this one, with Weinbridge oscillator circuit, I think our discussion on RC oscillator circuit will be completed. So for Weinbridge oscillator circuit, what has been done is, instead of connecting only one amplifier, eventually there are two amplifiers are connected. We have seen that for this circuit, for this phase shift oscillator circuit, one amplifier is connected, only one amplifier is there, which provides a phase shift of 180 degree, and additional 180 degree phase difference is provided by the feedback network itself, or back network itself. Now, for the Weinbridge oscillator circuit, if I just draw the circuit diagram in a generic mode, it looks something like this. So there are two amplifiers. So this is amplifier one, and there is another amplifier, which is known as amplifier 2. In fact, the second amplifier will act as an inverter only. First amplifier will provide a gain as well as a phase reversal, whereas the second amplifier will not provide any gain. Rather, it will just invert the signal. That means the gain is insignificant. Now, there is a back network. There is a back network B, which gets an input from the output of the amplifier 2, and this is provided. To the input of the amplifier circuit. So in fact, this particular back network will provide two different feedback, one positive feedback and another negative feedback. However, at the signal frequency, the impact of the positive feedback is more as compared to that of the negative feedback. But you must wonder why should I require this back network at all? This is required so as to provide the stability of the frequency of oscillation. Otherwise, the frequency stability will be lost. We must argue that since both of these amplifiers are in common emitter mode, so both of these amplifiers are common emitter amplifiers, single stage common emitter. So when they are connected in a cascade, so from this point to this point, from this point to this point, there will be 360 degree phase difference, because this first stage C amplifier will provide 180 degree phase difference. So from here to here, you have 180 degree phase difference, and from here to here, you have another 180 degree phase difference. So what if it is connected, if the output of the second amplifier is connected directly to the input of the first amplifier, just bypassing this back network, then also you can see that there is 180 degree plus 180 degree, so total 360 degree phase difference. But the thing is that if you make any attempt for direct coupling, then the stability of the corresponding frequency operation will be lost. So that's why the output of the second amplifier is connected through a bridge network. So here, this back network will consist of a bridge, which is having four different arms. And obviously, there will be frequency selective elements within the arms of that particular back network. And the back network will provide both the positive feedback as well as the negative feedback. The negative feedback is there to provide a constant output, and the positive feedback is there to invoke the concept of oscillation. So in general, this is the fundamental block diagram of a Weinbridge oscillator, in which case we must explore this one, this back network, by means of some Weinbridge circuit. So how does it look like? So if I just closely want to represent this one. So basically, we have a circuit like this. So there are four arms. Involving frequency selective elements. So this is a Weinbridge circuit. So this is coming, this point is connected to the output of amplifier 2. So this point is connected to the out of amplifier 2. And this point is fed to the input of amplifier 1, in of amplifier 1. And in the form of a positive feedback. So we'll be establishing how this positive feedback is maintained over here. So obviously, there will be another a certain condition that has to be satisfied. That means this Barkhausen condition has to be satisfied. And secondly, this point is also connected, and it is provided to the amplifier 1 as well as negative feedback. And this negative feedback is provided so as to ensure that there is a constant output over here. So before discussing further, I think it would be better if I just go to the corresponding circuit diagram, then you can understand it much better way. So start with, this is the first stage of amplifier, C amplifier, involving C say RB and RC, these two resistances are RB1 and RC1. It is connected to the second stage by means of a coupling capacitor. Now the second stage basically will act as an inverter, so it will not amplify the signal, it will only invert the signal. Amplification is accomplished in the first stage itself, so let it be R1, R2, let it be RC2. So this is grounded. So let it be RE2. So out, so this is the VCC supply line. This has been the output terminal of the second stage. Now this output terminal is connected at the input of the back network. So in this particular case, the back network is nothing but a bridge having four arms. Now once again, let me draw the arms, four arms first. So this is the first arm involving R and C in series path. And the second one is nothing but R and C in the shunt path. And there are two resistances in the other two arms as well. So I'll be explaining what is the purpose of this resistance. So let it be like, say R1, C1. R2, C2, this is R3, this is R4. Now from this point, it is connected to the input of the first stage. That means the positive feedback is established. And this point is connected to the output of the second stage. And as I've already mentioned, this particular voltage, which is coming in the form of voltage divider, this is connected in the negative feedback fashion. So that's why it is connected over here. Already, you know, if something is for a common emitter amplifier, if some voltage is connected at the emitter terminal, it will essentially act as a kind of series feedback, negative feedback. So it is connected in this particular fashion. So this is the total final output. We are getting the final output from this particular point, VO. Now what happens over here, the voltage, output voltage is applied at this particular point for the bridge network. Let me summarize once again. For the bridge network, it is having four arms. In one arm, you have R1 and C1 in series. In the other arm, you have R2 and C2 in shunt path. And in the third and fourth arm, you have two different resistances. Now, the output signal resulting from the second stage of the amplifier is connected at this particular point, and the voltage that is developed at this particular point is being fed to the input of the first stage. So you need to find out what is the amount of signal that is basically coupled. So this is nothing but the back network for whose input is VO and the output is, say, VO dashed. Suppose this one is VO dashed. So if I want to represent this in a different way, so basically you have two impedances. So you have applied VO This one is Z S, for example, series. This one is ZP, the parallel. And this is the signal which is being fed to the input of the first stage. So this one is ZS. So what is ZS? This is nothing but R and C is in series. And what is ZP? R and C in shunt. So this is ZP. So let me assume that this R1 and R2, they are same, and C1 and C2, they are also same. Now under this condition, what will be the ratio between V0 dash and V0? As you know, V0 dash upon V0 is given by ZP upon ZP plus ZS. ZP upon ZP plus ZS. Now let me calculate what is ZP or what is ZS first. This is nothing but R plus 1 upon SC. R and C in series path. So 1 plus SRC upon SC. What is ZP? ZP is nothing but R into 1 by SC upon R plus 1 by SC. If I multiply with SC, so you have R divided by 1 plus SRC. So I have to calculate this ratio ZP upon ZP plus ZS. Before that, let me write it down. What is ZS? ZS is given by 1 plus SRC upon SC, and ZP is given by R by 1 plus SRC. Let me check once again. 1 plus SRC by SC, and the second one is R by 1 plus SRC. Okay, fine. So what about ZP by ZP plus ZS? The feedback factor. This is R upon 1 plus SRC divided by R upon 1 plus SRC plus 1 plus SRC by SC. So the numerator side, you have R by 1 plus SRC. The denominator, you have SC into 1 plus SRC over here. Then SRC plus 1 plus SRC whole square. If you simplify, so this is nothing but SRC in the numerator. And in the denominator side, we have SRC plus 1 plus SRC whole square. So SRC plus 1 plus 2 SRC plus SRC whole square. So ultimately, we have SRC upon 1 plus 3 SRC plus SRC whole square. So if I represent once again in terms of frequency, so this is the feedback factor, ZP upon ZP plus ZS. So B is given by this one. So B as a function of frequency, this is nothing but J omega RC upon 1 minus omega square R square C square plus 3 J omega RC. Once again, you know, to ensure that this time, this back network will not provide any additional phase shift, because this particular network, the combination of these two, this first stage and second stage, they have provided 360 degree phase difference. So this network must not provide any additional phase difference over here. The total phase difference must be 0 degree. So to make sure that this B does not provide any additional phase shift, so 1 minus omega square R square C square must be equal to 0. For which case I am finding that omega is equal to 1 by RC, or F is equal to 1 by 2 pi RC. So this is the frequency of oscillation. Now under this condition, what is the value of B? So you find that numerator you have J omega RC, denominator you have 0 plus 3 j omega rc. So ultimately this feedback factor is resulting to be 1 upon 3. So this particular network, this feedback network, this back network itself, it provides zero phase difference and a corresponding attenuation of 1/3. So to compensate these two stages of amplification, they must provide a gain of 3 so that the Barkhausen condition is satisfied. Because you know to ensure that the Barkhausen condition to get satisfied, the total phase difference while traversing through the loop must be equal to 0 degree total phase difference. So from this point to this point, 180 degree phase difference. From this point to this point, another 180 degree phase difference. So from this point to this point, there is 0 degree phase difference. So through this network, there must not be any additional phase difference. And the second part is that, you know, to maintain a sustained oscillation, the corresponding loop gain must be equal to 1. So here already 1/3 attenuation is obtained through this particular network. So the rest of the network involving this first stage of amplification and the second stage of amplification, they must provide the gain of 3 so as to ensure that the Barkhausen condition is satisfied. Then obviously I have already mentioned that what is the use of these two different resistances. In fact, what happens, this particular resistance is not a simple resistance, rather it depends upon the amount of current which is flowing through it. That means if the amount of current flowing through this particular resistance is more, then the corresponding value of resistance will also increase. Now what happens here, V naught is connected at this particular point, so the voltage over here, the negative voltage that will be developed over here, you can easily find out that voltage is nothing but R4 upon R3 plus R4 into V naught, which is acting as a negative feedback because this is connected to the emitter side of the common emitter amplifier. And if some voltage is connected in the emitter side, so it's a kind of series mixing, and this mixing is happening in the form of voltage. So the effective voltage over here, the input voltage over here for this first stage is nothing but this voltage difference between base to emitter. Now, if in the emitter side, there is another source of voltage instead of connecting it to ground, if I directly connect it to ground, then obviously this potential will be constant. Now, instead of connecting this potential to ground, what is done is I've connected this potential, this point, at this particular node. So in case V naught increases by some means, then what happens? The corresponding current flowing through R4 will also increase, and the property of this particular resistance is such that while the current flowing through it increases, then the corresponding resistance value will also increase. So as a matter of fact, when V naught increases, the feedback voltage also increases. Now this feedback voltage is applied as a negative input or negative feedback. So when V naught increases, the corresponding negative feedback will also increase. As a matter of fact, it will try to reduce the value of V naught. On the other hand, if V naught reduces to some extent, then the current flowing through this R4 will also reduce. And as a matter of fact, as a property of R4, corresponding current, since the current is flowing through R4 is reducing, the resistance value of R4 will also reduce, and the feedback voltage, which is connected to the input of the first stage, will also reduce. So when V naught increases, the feedback voltage increases, and when V naught decreases, in effect, the negative feedback also reduces. So as a matter of fact, this R4 resistance will try to stabilize the output of the oscillator, and the positive feedback is essentially provided by this RC network, which comprises of series RC as well as a shunt RC in two branches of this particular wind bridge circuit. So this particular network is known as wind bridge oscillator. This is another type of RC oscillator. So today we have discussed about two different types of RC oscillator. One is phase shift RC oscillator, for which the frequency oscillation we have obtained like 1 by 2 pi root 6 RC. And for this wind bridge oscillator, the frequency oscillation is given by 1 by 2 pi RC. And the feedback factor over here is given by 1 upon 3 feedback factor. So the amplifier gain must be equal to 3 at least, so that the Barkhausen condition is satisfied. And out of these two networks, this first network will provide, or this first amplifier will provide the corresponding gain, whereas the second amplifier, as you obtain, as you observe over here, this gain is essentially governed by RC by RD ratio. And if I select RC and RD to be close enough, so in that case, the second stage of amplifier will not provide an additional gain. Rather, it will just invoke a phase difference of 180 degree. So the first stage will act as an amplifier as well as an inverter, whereas the second stage will act only as an inverter. Now with this, I think we have come to the close of the discussion on RC phase shift oscillator. And in the next class, I'll be talking about the LC oscillator.